Hello everyone. We are here at the Aging, Metabolism and Emotion Center on the University of California, San Francisco campus. I am here with Dr. Robert Lustig.
And I am here with Dr. Joan Ifland. I am a pediatric endocrinologist.
And I am the author of Processed Food Addiction, and Dr. Lustig is the author of The Hacking of the American Mind.
And this video is the intersection between those two issues.
Yes, we unknowingly wrote continuums of each other's books. I'm very pleased to be here with Dr. Lustig. He has inspired me to look beyond the edges of processed food addiction to greater cultural addictions. So maybe we could start with the intersection of screen addiction and processed food addiction.
Well, as you know, but perhaps the audience doesn't, every substance and every behavior that causes the release of a chemical in the brain called dopamine. Dopamine is the reward neurotransmitter, and there is an area of the brain called the reward center, also known as the nucleus accumbens. Every single substance and or behavior that causes the release of dopamine in the extreme leads to addiction. Mm-hmm. There's an aholic after every single one of those, mm-hmm. whether it's cocaine, heroin, nicotine, alcohol, sugar, which is where we meet, mm-hmm. or behaviors. So,
shopaholic.
Shopping, yep, gambling.
Gambleaholic.
Right.
Sexaholics.
Exactly.
Relationshipaholics.
And now, video gameaholic.
Yes, and screenaholics.
And social mediaholic.
Right.
So, it's not about the substance per se, it's about the dopamine release. So the question is, if the extreme of each of these pleasures leads to addiction, what's going on, who's in control, and how do we back out of it?
Well, that takes us to the environment. So, and the way I think about addictions that stem from the culture, I think that the environment is stimulating the production of this dopamine, which leads to hyperactive stress pathways. But for most of us, it also leads to disengagement of our thinking pathways or our brakes. So there's two steps. One, we get the flood of craving chemicals, but two, our braking system fails. So no matter what kind of aholic it is, those reactions in the brain are going on, and that's why it's not our fault.
Indeed. There's an area in the brain right behind your forehead called the prefrontal cortex. Some people call it the executive function center. Some people call it the delayed gratification center. Mm-hmm. I call it in my book the Jiminy Cricket of
yes,
your brain. It's
I
the part
that.
Of your brain that
I
keeps you
that.
From doing stupid things.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Apparently, some politicians and Supreme Court nominees are have a problem with this area. The
Do
bottom
you think?
maybe. The bottom line is that dopamine causes that area of the brain to reduce in activity.
Yes.
And stress puts it into suspended animation, letting your cravings, your wildest excitable
impulses
basically predominate your behavior and, of course, your consumption. And that's what we're seeing today.
Yeah, so I think the important thing for, if you think that you have become addicted to screens or shopping or processed foods, to know that when the impulse is active, when the craving is active, that you're not thinking, you're not really choosing, you're not really making decisions. It's more like a reflexive reaction. So the dopamine, you get the dopamine surge, you do something in reaction, the dopamine wears off, and then you're standing there and you're thinking, why did I do that? I know better. But the I know better part was not working. It's so important to come back to this idea that this is not your fault and you're not choosing.
Indeed. Ultimately, the area of the brain that controls all of this, that prefrontal cortex, is the most vulnerable part of the brain.
Yes, yes.
And it's particularly vulnerable for adolescents.
Yes, good point.
And the reason why it's so vulnerable is because that is the last area to myelinate. Now, myelin is the fatty sheath that covers neurons, that protects neurons from dying. Now, neurons like to be excited.
Yes.
But
that's a good way to put it.
Neurons like to be tickled, not bludgeoned. Chronic overstimulation of any neuron leads to neuronal cell death. And we know this as in pediatrics because we have kids who end up in the intensive care unit from, you know, chronic seizure disorders, status epilepticus, and when you do the MRIs, you see neurons falling out because of the long-term overstimulation.
Right.
Now, the neurons that respond to dopamine, they don't want to die, but they're being constantly bombarded. So they have a fail-safe. They have a defense mechanism. What they do is they down-regulate the number of receptors, proteins that interact with dopamine.
Mm-hmm.
By doing so, less likely that any given dopamine molecule will find a receptor because there are just fewer of them.
And create pleasure.
Right. So when that happens, you end up needing more to get less.
Yes.
So you get a hit, you get a rush, and the hit can be cocaine, alcohol, sugar,
ice cream,
cheeseburger. It can also
French fries.
It can also be likes on Facebook.
Yes, you know?
So that's what's new.
That's what's so scary.
Right, it's the new dopamine.
So
you get a hit, you get a rush. Receptors go down to protect the neuron. Next time you need a bigger hit to get the same rush, and then the receptors go down, and then a bigger hit, a bigger hit, a bigger hit, until you need a huge hit to get nothing. That's called tolerance.
Yeah.
And then when the neurons actually start to die, that's called addiction.
Well, you know, and you see this in the grocery store, because 50 years ago, the bag of chips was this big, and now the bag of chips is this big. And to my way of thinking, that's because of what exactly Dr. Lustig is talking about, tolerance. So maybe 50 years ago, people would eat a bag of chips and they'd be satisfied. But today, they're buying the family size, but they're eating it themselves.
Well, you're talking about dietary quantity. I think there's a problem with dietary quality as well.
Oh, yes.
Because the food has actually changed.
Yes.
If you look at where the sugar, which is the one substance which has actually been shown to be addictive, one food substance, I should say, along with caffeine, It has been added to all the food in the grocery store.
Yes.
Of the 600,000 items in the American grocery store, 74% of them have been spiked with added sugar.
That's exactly right.
On purpose, by the food industry for their purposes, not for yours. Because they know when they add it, you buy more. It is cheap filler, and it makes it fly off the shelf, and they know it.
Yes. So you're talking about the confluence of two terrible factors in the 1980s, the invention of high fructose corn syrup, and the seizing of control of the processed food industry by the tobacco industry.
Well, that happened even a little earlier. That happened in the 60s, in fact. Although Altria, for instance,
Philip
Morris ended up buying Kraft and General Foods, and RJR bought Nabisco. So, you know, they were diversifying. The point was that they were using the same model.
The same business addiction business model.
And some of the people were even the same people.
Yes, yes.
There's a guy named Robert Hockett who worked for both of them.
Right.
The bottom line is these are not mistakes.
Oh, no.
They knew what they were doing.
Very deliberate.
And to top it all off, when we had the late 70s with the original dietary guidelines for Americans, which told us to eat less fat, well, low-fat food tastes like cardboard. So they had to do something to make the food palatable, i.e. saleable. And so what they do, they added the sugar. So we had actually three things, and even four things,
all coming together
at the same time. Number one, Nixon said, make food cheap. Number two, Hurricane Allen, which destroyed the Caribbean sugar crop and made high fructose corn syrup even more necessary. Number three, the dietary guidelines. And finally, number four, the food industry recognizing the addictive properties of sugar.
And I think out of that, the last one is particularly heartbreaking because that meant that those tobacco executives who always wanted to get at the 10-year-old boys, they could now get at toddlers.
That's right.
And you saw that in your practice.
I did. But it's even more than toddlers. It's now fetuses.
Yes.
Because we actually have the data in animals, not in humans yet. So we're working on humans. It's tough. It's hard to do that kind of work. But in animals, showing that sugar crosses the placenta and alters neural organization in the developing
in the fetus
and causes tolerance even before you're born.
So this is one of the ways that we know that this is a drug and not a food, because we see that kind of evidence in drug users as well.
That's right.
So let's talk about some solutions. All right.
Okay. Well, there are only a few solutions that work, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason is because we're not in control. The food industry is in control. The technology industry is in control. People think they get to choose what they eat. Well, actually, no, you don't.
Because it's the reward system driving the behavior and not the decision making.
Well, also because if all the food's contaminated, what are you supposed to do?
Right.
So, people say, well, you get to choose what goes into your mouth. Actually, it's been chosen for you.
Right. By availability, too.
And
advertising.
And by
affordability.
Cost. Right,
yep.
Exactly.
Right.
So, in order to exercise personal responsibility for any phenomenon, including addictive phenomena, there have to be four caveats that have to be met. They are, number one, knowledge. You have to have the knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we're kept from the knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
We are very specifically.
We're fixing that right here.
Well, we're very specifically kept from the knowledge by the food industry and by the FDA.
Thank you.
Now, the old food label said total sugars. It didn't say added sugars. It didn't tell you what they did to the food.
Mm-hmm.
It just said what was in the food.
So an apple would look like it had sugar in it, and we shouldn't be eating apples.
Exactly.
Very deceptive.
Exactly. So what we need to know is not what is in the food, but what's been done
added
to the food.
To the food.
So added sugar was supposed to be put on the label back in 1989.
Mm-hmm.
Except that the food industry lobbied the FDA
and
said, if we told consumers how much sugar we added to our products, our competitors could reverse engineer our recipes. This is proprietary information, and you can't know it.
Right.
And you know what the FDA said?
Okay.
Okay. Right.
Okay.
So the new food label, and I put that in quotes because we're not going to see the new food label because the Trump administration ditched it. The new food label was supposed to have added sugars on it. Well, guess what? It won't. And the reason it won't is because that's the food industry's juggernaut.
You know, I am at the point where I tell my followers, if it's in a package, it's been processed.
Indeed.
And you really don't know what's in it because they're not really required to put all the food additives in it. If it's in a package, it's just keep going. Go over to the produce section. Get something that's not in a package.
I'll give you a better mantra.
Okay.
If a food has a label, it's a warning label.
Yes, I love that. I love that. Okay, perfect.
It's just that simple.
Yeah, you
because
don't need to
food,
read labels if it has a label. Keep going.
Because real food doesn't need a label because nothing's been done to
right.
it.
Right. You can tell it's celery. It doesn't have a label because it's obviously celery.
Exactly.
Talk to us about these four C's that you have in the Hacking of the American Mind. I love that.
Sure. So ultimately, we've defined two problems. We've defined dopamine and we've defined stress.
Mm-hmm.
And cortisol, of course, is the hormone of stress. But there's another neurotransmitter we have not talked about, and that is serotonin.
Right.
Now, serotonin is the happiness neurotransmitter. It is the contentment neurotransmitter.
Mm-hmm.
It is the neurotransmitter that tells your brain, this feels good, I don't want or need anymore.
Anymore,
compared
yes.
to dopamine, which is, this feels good, I want more.
Right.
So these are two different phenomena.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. This pleasure, happiness, and that's what the book is about.
Yes.
Pleasure is short-lived, happiness is long-lived, pleasure is visceral, you feel it in the body, happiness is ethereal, you feel it above the neck, pleasure is taking, happiness is giving, yes. Pleasure is achieved alone, happiness is usually
yes.
achieved in social groups.
Yes.
Pleasure can be achieved with substances, happiness cannot be achieved with substances, mm-hmm. The extremes of pleasure lead to addiction, there's no such thing as being addicted to too much happiness.
Yes.
And finally, pleasure is dopamine, happiness is serotonin. So. The goal to treat addiction, the goal to improve our lives is threefold. Get the serotonin up, get the dopamine down, get the cortisol down.
Yes, okay.
Those three.
And you've got these four methods. It's not like this is theoretical. We can just translate this right into day-to-day practice.
Right. The problem is the industry, not just the food industry, the technology industry, and the gaming industry, et cetera, they all want you hooked. They all want
yes.
you addicted, because
that's
where their
the
money comes from.
And they have the technology to do it.
And they do.
They hire those neuroscientists, and they do things like, this persuasive design on screens.
There is a company in L.A. called Dopamine Labs. They will take your app and make it addictive.
Oh.
I don't want to give them a shout out because I'm trying to shut them down.
Right.
But the fact is that what they do is they introduce the phenomenon of variable reward
yes.
into any app.
Yes.
Okay. They basically gamify it. They
yes.
turn it into
variable reward.
A slot machine.
Mm-hmm.
And by doing so, they actually game your reward center.
Yes.
And they up your dopamine, and in the process, your serotonin goes down, and you become more stressed. And everyone who uses any of these apps ends up most decidedly unhappy.
Mm-hmm. That's what's so sad,
because
you think you're going for happiness, and you end up unhappy.
That's right.
Yeah.
So in order to get your serotonin up, you have to get your dopamine down. The more pleasure you seek, the more unhappy you
mm-hmm.
get. So, what are these four C's? The great news is every single one of them is available to everyone on the planet.
Yes.
Every single one of them is free.
Yes.
Every single one of them is something your mother told you.
Yes.
And every single one of them is absolutely guaranteed, evidence-based, will work, or 100% your money back, but since none of them cost anything, don't expect a refund.
Yeah. So the first one is to connect. So if you tell us about that I will tell the audience what we're doing to connect our members.
Very good. So connect does not mean connectivity. Two different things. Facebook is connectivity. They say it. What we're talking about is eye-to-eye, face-to-face
mm-hmm.
connection.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Why is that important? Here's why. There is a set of neurons in the back of your head, in the occipital lobe. You can record from them. They're called mirror neurons.
Yep.
And they are reading the facial expressions of the person you are talking to, like you and I are right now, in real time.
So I just want to pause here. If this is the only thing you remember out of this whole recording, this is it. Mirror neurons. Go on there.
Well, so what you're doing is you are transducing a signal
mm-hmm.
that drives serotonin
mm-hmm.
because you are adopting the emotions of the person you're talking
right.
to. And we have a name
right.
for this. It's called empathy.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can't do it, you are a psychopath.
Yes. We're not saying anything. Anybody here is a psychopath. But
No.
But
named a few before.
Okay. And why is this so important to a food addict in particular? It's because food addiction isolates us. We get joint pain. We get depression. We get irritability. We get brain fog. We might collect fat tissue on our bodies, and it might become unpleasant for us to go outside.
More,
so we lose our connections.
More importantly, food addicts eat alone.
Yes, because they're ashamed. The
shame
issue is very big.
Absolutely.
So this is why we're translating this into online communities via the Zoom platform, and we offer a lot of video chats. And people think, oh, video chats, how is that going to help me? Dr. Lustig just told us. the video chats, eye to eye. There's something about that eye to eye connection that's so important.
So you cannot have a conversation with anonymous. Doesn't work.
Right.
Does not work.
Right.
So that's number one. Number two, contribute.
Yes.
And that does not mean to your IRA.
Right. Although that's not a bad idea.
Well, saving is a form of happiness, and it definitely increases serotonin. However,
which is also destroyed by addiction.
However, contributing means outside of yourself.
Yes.
To the greater good.
Person.
That's
yeah.
right. Okay. The golden rule, if you will, do unto others as you have them do unto you. The mm-hmm. bottom line is, we live in a community. It's part of the reason for connection. Ultimately, your giving mm-hmm. translates into your happiness.
Mm-hmm.
You get more than you give. Now, there are loads of, you know, mantras, you know, on the internet, you know, with this kind of thing. But the fact of the matter is that the data show why this drives serotonin production as opposed to dopamine.
Mm-hmm.
Lottery winners are not happy. In fact,
yes.
lottery winners are among the most unhappy people
yes.
alive.
Yes.
Okay, so getting money does not solve the problem. Giving money actually solves the problem.
Yes. So we teach, for example, we teach kindness. Even, you know, it's not like you have to go and interview and for some big volunteer job. You can be kind to the cashier, kind to the person on the street. You can contribute to their well-being in really simple ways. And as Dr. Lustig says, it is free. Being kind doesn't cost one thing, and it makes you feel really good. So contribution, yes. Being of service to other people, oh, such a good feeling.
Remember also, you know, there's this data on smiling.
Uh-huh.
Okay? Well, the
uh-huh.
fact is, if you smile, people smile back, and then you feel better because you're reading that.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole concept of community, ultimately,
yes.
you cannot be happy if you are alone.
You know, when we have a program, the Addiction Reset Community, and people have come into our program before they do anything about anything else in their life, their food, their relationships, before anything, they say, oh, I feel so much better. My depression is 50% better. It's because of what Dr. Lustig is saying. They're getting serotonin releases, which are really fun.
Number three.
Okay.
Cope.
Yeah.
So that whole prefrontal cortex thing.
Mm-hmm.
Ultimately, we have to exercise our prefrontal cortex.
Yes.
In the same way I have to exercise our muscles, we have to
yes.
exercise our prefrontal cortex. Well, the prefrontal cortex is there to help you and make you focus.
Uh-huh.
If you cognitively focus, and you need to basically cognitively focus on one thing, and mindfulness, as an example,
mm-hmm.
which is a big word nowadays,
mm-hmm.
is focusing on nothing.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing you're focusing on, is
and that's
nothing.
Easy and free.
And that is
yeah.
hard to do.
Well, it is hard to do.
It is hard to do, and it takes yeah. a lot of skill and a lot of practice. But ultimately, what it's doing is it's exercising that prefrontal cortex.
Right.
So why is that important? Well, because that prefrontal cortex is tamping down that dopamine signal
yes.
and allowing
yes.
for serotonin to work.
Yes.
And by reducing that cortisol, you are reducing your ability to be distracted. You are
mm-hmm.
also reducing your risk for chronic metabolic diseases in
yes.
the future. Because
yes.
cortisol is about the worst thing for
it's
virtually every disease.
Right?
It's the inhibitor of inflammation, but at great cost.
And as it wears out, doesn't inflammation
oh,
and
then it'll
processed
come up.
Foods are sure. inflammatory.
Absolutely.
So this is how these mental gymnastics get translated into physical, chronic, debilitating, distressful, painful disease.
Indeed.
So it's not just up here. And let me just jump in here for a second. Processed foods actually, I think there is evidence of processed foods impede the ability to pay attention.
So in part because of the dopamine.
Yes, you're really in all of these steps that Dr. Lustig is describing. You are undoing alterations created by addictions, by the screen addiction, by the cultural addictions, by the processed food addiction, and then Sometimes people, of course, have turned to drug addiction as a Absolutely. Way of coping with all these other addictions. Okay.
Without question. Right. You know, that's sort of like the end game, if you
yeah.
will.
Yeah.
You know, sugar is kind of like the gateway drug.
Yes.
And, you know,
yes.
ultimate. And actually, there's data on that. All you have to do, those of you who are watching, ever been to an AA meeting?
Uh-huh.
What's in the back room?
And the front room, and the side room.
The rock stars, the brownies, you know, the it's and the cigarettes, of course.
Yeah.
You know, I understand why. I understand that those are more socially acceptable than being
addictions.
Drunk, and you know, and in terms of the addiction. But ultimately, it's addiction transfer.
Yes.
And the reason that this is addiction transfer is because you only have one reward center.
Mm-hmm.
You only have one dopamine system.
Mm-hmm.
If you've reduced your dopamine receptors, it doesn't matter what did the reducing. They're now reduced. And so if you try to abstain from whatever it is that got you addicted, you're actually now tolerant of everything else because you still have a reduction in receptors.
And
this is what happened to Carney Wilson when she underwent bariatric surgery. She became an alcoholic.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, people stop smoking, they start drinking. They stop
mm-hmm.
drinking, they start eating.
Mm-hmm.
Ultimately, you have to figure out how to not switch your addiction, but how to get unaddicted. And the only way is by exercising that prefrontal cortex.
Well, and where this takes us back to our first C, which is it's well supported recommendation that before you try to address an addiction, get into a community. So get your serotonin production under control in a community, learn some kindness techniques perhaps, so that when you do back off that dopamine stimulation, you don't just switch over from food addiction to sex addiction or shopping addiction. You actually recalibrate and balance out brain function so that you're happy enough that you don't go over to a new addiction. And you've got one more C for us.
I do. So cook is the last one. So there are three items in food that matter in terms of this pathway of addiction and happiness. Number one, tryptophan. Tryptophan is the rarest amino acid in the
mm-hmm.
diet. It is found in eggs, chicken, and poultry.
Yeah.
Turkey, yeah, poultry. The bottom line is that's not processed food.
Yeah.
Okay, you don't,
yeah.
I mean, turkey jerky. I mean, but the bottom line is it's pretty uncommon in processed food.
Mm-hmm.
So processed food is very high in carbohydrate, which actually reduces serotonin even more and in and of itself can cause depression. But the addiction associated with processed food, as you've nicely laid out and nicely delineated, ultimately leads to reduction in tryptophan. So
mm-hmm.
you can't even drive that happiness signal.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, omega-3 fatty acids. Now, omega-3 fatty acids are heart-healthy, anti-inflammatory, anti-Alzheimer's, save your life. It is
totally.
Perhaps the only thing about fat that everybody in the nutrition world agrees on
yep.
is that omega-3s are good for you.
That
well, it turns out if you take omega-3 deficient rats, and you look at their brains under the microscope, at the serotonin nerve terminals, there is this inflammatory haze.
Oh, really?
And when you give the omega-3s back, that haze goes away.
Okay.
The assumption being that it's interfering with serotonin neurotransmission.
So nutritional deficiencies actually set us up for the addiction.
No question.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally, the bad one, sugar,
yeah.
where there's too much.
Yeah.
And sugar, because it raises dopamine, lowers serotonin, because of stress, you end up consuming more sugar.
Mm-hmm.
Bottom line, A, high sugar, low tryptophan, low omega-3 diet, that's called processed food.
And it's highly addictive. So we see research like it only takes 7 days of a rat drinking a 30% sugar solution to see the brain start to make those addictive adaptations. This is highly addictive. This is not just mildly addictive, it's really addictive.
Well, and the other thing is that it takes 3 weeks for those dopamine receptors to come back once you abstain. And the problem
only
is
3 weeks,
and
guys.
The problem is you still have cravings, and you it's very easy to sort of fall off the other side.
That is why, again, going back to community, get in an online group. Even if you can't, if you're not mobile, find an online group like the Addiction Reset community, because they will walk you through those 3 weeks. And instead of thinking, oh, my head hurts so much, I'm going to just eat some sugar to make the pain go away, you have your cheerleaders there saying, just hang on, the worst of it will be over in 2 days, and so you hang on. Going back to what Dr. Lustig said, it is knowledge. It's knowledge of what is going on. All right, let's go to our last one.
Well, so, I mean, So, ultimately, processed food is high sugar, low tryptophan, low omega-3s. Real food is low sugar, high tryptophan, high omega-3s.
Mm-hmm.
Processed food is an experiment that failed.
Yes.
We know why it came, for all the reasons we discussed earlier in this video.
Tobacco model.
And it doesn't work.
No. Sorry.
And I'll be honest with you, it doesn't not just work from a metabolic standpoint, it doesn't work from an environmental standpoint, from a climate change standpoint.
Economic?
From an economic standpoint. So you could say, well, wait a second, if you look at the processed food industry, they've made money hand over fist. And
but
they did until about 2014. Fact is, they're not doing so hot right now. You'll notice that McDonald's CEO Don Thompson was fired for poor performance.
Yes.
Dark Kent, the former CEO of Coke,
mm-hmm.
had to save $3 billion and fired 18,000 employees.
Mm-hmm.
Indra Nooyi tried to fix Pepsi.
And they didn't want her to fix it.
And she lost $349 million in an attempt.
And lost her job.
Well, no, she ultimately salvaged her job, but now she is stepped down.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, Nestle has divested themselves of their $2.8 billion confectionery business here in the United States, selling it to Ferrero Rocher, the Nutella people.
Interesting.
So they get it. They know. They know this is a problem, and they don't want to be on the wrong side of history.
Mm-hmm.
Others have also come forward, not just Nestle, but Unilever, the ice cream people, Mars, the Snickers people, and Danone as well, have all signed an agreement, and you can find it online, that says that they know this is a problem. Campbell's Soup, Denise Morrison, tried to fix it. She ultimately got fired. The bottom line is the food industry knows they're
in
trouble.
They know it.
They have not yet figured out how to make money selling real food.
It's just, and there's not the same margin.
And they can't.
No.
Until the business model changes.
So you say to cook at home, and I say to cook at home. It is the only way you know what is in your food. And we have, I have a little food prep manual out at Amazon called Dr. Iflin's Food Prep Manual. And it shows you how to make all your food for the week in 2 hours. Now, I could go through the motions of filling up a crock pot. Here's my crock pot. Here's my package of some kind of meat. Open the package, put it in the crock pot. Dump in a bag of carrots. Dump in a bag of potatoes. Put the lid on. So I just made food for 4 days in 60 seconds. Okay, pantomime. So Dr. Lustig makes a good point in his book, The Hacking of the American Mind, which cooking promotes his other three C's.
Indeed. So sitting down and having a meal with your family.
For example.
Cooking, not your extended family. That's called Thanksgiving. That's a whole other thing. But
remember, we're trying to manage stress here.
Right. It's connecting.
Mm-hmm.
It's contributing.
Mm-hmm.
It's coping, because
yeah.
you have to be mindful when you're cooking.
Yeah.
And you're cooking. So it is the single best thing you can do for yourself. We have a cookbook called The Fat Chance Cookbook.
Yes,
where we teach people how to cook six courses in a half an hour.
Yes, real food.
And how to ultimately be able to parlay that into health, benefits, and happiness.
I have to mention that this book was tested by high school students. So anyone out there who thinks I can't cook, get the Fat Chance cookbook. But here's the other thing that I would like to connect, which is if you're cooking at home, but nobody else in your environment is cooking at home, you can't sustain that because of the mirror neuron issue. The mirror neuron issue is attached to tribal instincts. And those instincts say, do what your tribe is doing and you will live. If you get separated from your tribe, you will die. So if you're the only one cooking, nobody else is cooking, everybody else in your environment is going out for fast food, you can't sustain that. Your brain will not let you sustain that habit. So get into a community, even like an online community where people are cooking, that you can sustain.
In fact, if you look at the data from the Framingham study back in the late 2000s, they showed that social interaction was a primary driver of obesity. And so it's who you know determines how fat you are.
Yes.
And it is almost assuredly through this phenomenon you just
yes,
described.
Just to translate what Dr. Leslie just said, if you're in a group of chronic overeaters, you will be a chronic overeater because your brain will drag you in that direction. But if you get into an online community of people who are eating clean, they're eating balanced meals, beautiful food, it's all beautiful, then your brain will drag you in that direction. This was cluster analysis. It was brilliant.
Just make sure it's
eye to eye.
Not.
And you got to have a
keyboard to keyboard.
A video chat. And what we have observed in the Addiction Reset community this year is that's enough. It is the eyeball. It's the visual and the audible. And, there's so many times we wish we could hug each other. We can't do that. And that's a very good thing to have happen, by the way. That releases all kinds of good things.
It does.
We don't have that physical contact, but we've got the audible and the visual, and that turns out to be enough.
Indeed. So the bottom line is for all of you out there, you can do this. You can fix it.
Yes.
You can drag yourself to wellness and happiness, but you have to have a compass. You have to know where you're going. You have to know what you're doing. You can't solve a problem if you don't know what the problem is.
Yes. If you don't know you have an addiction, if you're going to a health professional who doesn't know you have an addiction, that person can give you the best advice and you can have the best motivation, but you're not going to have a change because the addiction is not being addressed. To address an addiction, you need a clean food plan. You need a community. You need these things that Dr. Lustig is talking about. And your health professional might not know those things. They might think, well, why can't you follow a diet? What is wrong with you? It's not your fault. You're not getting a workable program.
So let me just mention all of these different diets out there.
Yes, good topic.
Ready? Atkins, vegan, paleo, Mediterranean, traditional Japanese, a few others while I'm at it.
Low carb, low fat, keto, it just goes
right
on and on. And name any celebrity, they've had a diet book out.
They're all the same.
Mm-hmm.
You say, wait, how can they all be the same? They're all the same. And the reason they're all the same is because they share two things in common: low sugar, high fiber, because every single one of those diets is real food. Not one of them has processed food on the menu.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the key. And my colleague Chris Gardner at Stanford showed it doesn't matter if you're on a low carb diet or a high carb diet. If it's a healthy diet, that is a low sugar, high fiber diet, it works.
It's the quality of the food.
The quality determines the quantity.
Yes, if you eat higher quality food with lots of fiber in it, you eat fewer calories naturally.
And even if you eat more calories, guess what? The bacteria in your intestine got them instead, because that's fiber's job, is to deliver a good percentage, 20 to 25% of what you ate, to your intestinal bacteria, which also promotes metabolic health.
Right.
So it's not about how many calories pass here, it's how many calories pass here, mm-hmm. and your bacteria determine that. So feed your bacteria for both metabolic and behavioral health. Emeryn Meyer, my colleague at UCLA, has demonstrated the gut-mind connection and has shown that depression actually starts in your gut.
In the gut. So let's stop there for a second and talk about children again, one of my favorite topics. People ask me all the time what to do about their kids. And I say, you don't have to do much about your kids if you control the environment in your home. What's available in the home? How much screen use is going on in the home? Do you have that television? The television is a big eating cue. It's eating stimulation.
Yeah, well, I'll give you a bigger eating stimulation. Okay, it's that iPad that you've given to the 15-month-old as the babysitter. That's the real danger.
It starts very young. So I tell people, look at what's happening in the environment. They say, oh, I don't want to fight with my kids. And I say, I don't want you to fight with your kids, and you don't have to fight with your kids. But know that even children will go into withdrawal. If you've ever seen a kid on the floor of the cereal aisle, that kid is fighting for a fix.
Worse yet, how many of you said, oh, I've got a horrible sweet tooth?
Mm-hmm.
That's sugar addiction.
Mm-hmm. So Dr. Lustig tells very poignant stories of the children that he's seen in his endocrinology practice here at UCSF. And to me, the carrier of those diseases is processed food addiction.
So processed food's the problem, real food's the solution. Addiction, metabolism, depression, you can fix them all. You can
yes.
fix them right now. All you have to do is, number one, recognize the problem,
mm-hmm.
and number two, want to fix it.
And get into the right community. And I do want to add here, to add to what Dr. Lustig is saying, neurons respond to training. So Dr. Lustig used the great example, if you want to have big bicep, you just do bicep curls. And if you want a really strong frontal lobe that's going to maintain its cognizance in the face of a craving, you just work it out. You just work out your neurons. Neuroplasticity, neurosculpting, the brain is repairable, it is fixable. We can take back this stimulation for altering the brain from these industries, and we can control it ourselves in a community.
With that, Dr. Iflin's book is Processed Food Addiction, where she goes into the science of the phenomenon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're not making this up, guys. So Dr. Lustig and I, we're working from the same mountain of research. So over the years, particularly since the advent of brain imaging, we have hundreds of thousands of studies on obesity, eating disorders, and drug addiction. So we're not making this up. This is there are 2,000 citations in processed food addiction. There are 650 citations in the Hacking of the American Mind. Both Dr. Lustig and I, we look at the research and we build from there. So is this real? Is this documented? Is it supported? Yes.
And
a lot.
And we're not taking money.
No.
We're just trying to help people.
Yeah. Well, there is a small fee for the addiction reset community, but it's a scaled fee and anybody can afford it.
Ultimately, we're here because we're doctors. We're trying to help.
And we are. Dr. Lustig goes around the world giving talks. I'm on Facebook every day. I know food addicts end up on Facebook. I'm there live. I'm watching over the posts. I'm in the video chats. I'm with you. I'm with you. I care about you. I understand you. I'm a recovering food addict myself, and I've suffered terribly from processed foods. So I get it. I see you. I understand you. And I think what we really want to say here, no matter how many diets you've tried, none of them were designed to address an addiction. So please try again. Try again. Use the addiction model. Get the Hacking of the American Mind. That's a well-written book. Processed Food Addiction is an academic book, a little bit tougher to read, but get the manual. Get Dr. Iflin's Food Prep Manual. You can do this.
I just want to say one last thing. All food is inherently good. It's what we do to the food that's not.
Mm-hmm.
So.
That's a great ending.
Eat real food.
Bye-bye, everybody. Thank you for coming.